today was about sequencing, and we touched a bit on the assembly, the protocols. Today, we're going to do as if we did the assembly of the genome, but then the next step is annotation. And with the annotation, we can actually also explore the genome structure. So basically, it means annotation means, in short, is turning raw sequence into knowledge. Or basically, you have a sequence, and on that sequence, I don't know if you see them, you have some motifs, a little bit faint. Between those motifs that are there, some exons can be there, and if you connect the exons together, you end up with a gene that you can actually translate. If you have a gene, of course, you also have some conserved areas, motifs, in the promoter region that are supposed to regulate the expression of the gene. So, and the motifs that you find there are basically binding sites of transcription factors. So basically, annotation is finding the biological relevant features on a raw genomic sequence, and preferably in a high-throughput manner. You don't want to do this manually. And so, why do we have to do a gene prediction as soon as we have the genome assembled? It's simply because the raw sequence as such is not very useful for biologists. You don't know where the genes are, you don't know the structure of those genes. Basically, if you have a protein or you do a mass spec, for instance, to identify proteins directly, you need to have those protein sequences, the sequence of those transcripts also that will be translated into proteins. So you need all those, all this information in order to be able to do other experiments, to actually exploit this resource. And basically, another way of saying is, for annotation, is sort of put landmarks on the sequence, reference points, and things that you can refer to. So, and therefore, it's of course the first step towards acquisition of knowledge. So gene prediction, it's actually already an old thing. Since the very beginning I'm doing bioinformatics, I've been doing gene prediction. And in the early times, last century, in the 90s, basically you had no software to predict genes. Simply because you had no genomes, except yeast was there already. There were some bacteria, but yeast and bacteria are sort of easy to predict. Simply because most of the genes are simple, have a very simple structure, in the sense that they're open reading frames from an ATG to a stop codon, so relatively simple. Since around 2000, the human genome came out, Arabidopsis, the plant model organism came out, the whole genome, and of course that not only were those genomes much bigger, but the structure of those genes were much more complex. For instance, in a human genome, you can have introns of 50, 100 KB. So that means that you have a little piece of your gene, and then you have to go 100 KB further away to find the next piece. And so that makes actually the whole regulation, the whole, even the expression, how can an organism basically find the rest of a gene like 100 KB further away? So all those kind of things it makes basically gene prediction quite complex. So the whole process is sort of well known. We know what we have to find, more or less, although the more we look, the more other things we find. Think about the microRNAs. Like 15 years ago, nobody knew about microRNAs. So those were not annotated, nobody looked at it. And it's only later on that people discovered them and saw that those tiny little transcripts actually had a very important regulatory role in the organism. But so, we know the system, we know how to, we have algorithms, we know how to deal with it, we know what we're sort of looking for, but it's not that the problem. And by this, I mean that, as I said, you have two types of genes, different new types of genes, sorry, like microRNAs, long non-coding RNAs, and all this only was discovered thanks to NGS and RNA-seq, because we saw that so much more was actually transcribed on a genome. Even in the introns of some genes, you can find other genes. So it's a complex thing, and so because all living organisms, they have DNA. Some people who are against genetically modified organisms are afraid of having DNA in their food, but actually everything has DNA. Anyway, every organism has DNA. It's as if every species has its own dialect. Basically, tiny little changes, a motif which is a little bit different. A typical example is GC content, can vary between one organism and another. And of course, that has all implications in gene prediction, because gene prediction is always composed out of two main components. That's one intrinsic, as we call it, which means based on statistical models. And another one, extrinsic, where you basically rely on extra information like ESTs, RNA-seq, protein similarity. So when we talk about gene prediction, basically we mostly refer to the algorithms, the models that we actually build. And the thing is also that ab initio, so intrinsic statistical models, can be applied across the whole genome. It's available across the whole genome. You can apply your models, statistical models, all over the whole sequence with ESTs in the previous time, or even with RNA-seq. You not necessarily have reads or transcripts of every single gene. Also, you don't have necessarily all the splice variants. So there's some limitation with the extrinsic data. It's not simply align all your RNA-seq and you have your annotation. It's actually much, much more complex than that. So the automated, and so also what you can have is that you have a distinction between automated and manual. With automated, we need the combination. We mean this, using software to actually run the models, do the predictions, but also include extrinsic data if we have any. Manual annotation is basically a human sitting in front of his computer based on evidence, alignments, etc., trying to find a gene model. And normally we will do, well, you will all get take a sequence and try to predict a gene. And also what we see is that it's also that the genomes on which we're working, well, actually, you cannot generalize this, but on the genomes we are working, they tend to get bigger and bigger and bigger. If you work on bacteria, of course, they will not get that much bigger. If you have 100 megabase bacteria, it's already quite a large genome. So we have then within the annotation, you also have structural annotation, which is, strictly speaking, only finding the borders and the pieces that constitute the gene. And then the other thing is functional annotation, and that is actually the next step is understand what is a gene actually doing. And those are two different things. So, and if you want to have real good genes, actually a perfect annotation, the most secure method is actually to design primers and to sequence the cDNA. That's the most reliable way, because then you can actually know where the gene begins, where it ends, where all the exons are. Of course, you cannot do this for a genome with 30,000 genes. So that's only useful for really when you're very focused and when basically the rest of your research depends on that specific gene model. So I was talking about intrinsic approaches, and typically what you have is you try to build models based on the information of the sequence itself. So that means that you're looking for pieces that are really coding for proteins, so to actually establish the codon usage, which might be specific between organisms. Certainly if you go to bacteria, codon usage is can be sometimes really very different between bacteria. And so we have to rely on codon usage, etc. But what you also have is codon usage. Those are statistics that you can calculate, build a model. And actually, as a side info, the models and the methods that are used to predict those things, the codon usage mainly, actually are derived from speech research. Basically, those are Markov models. So those are basically models that put relationship between different, in this case, characters, nucleotides, in order to define a model. And so the mathematics and all the calculations that need to be done were actually developed in the language research. So this way we could sort of, in the beginning, also a couple of years ago, well, last century, we attracted some people that were working on language recognition and were able basically to apply their technology or their knowledge to actually deciphering sequences. The other thing that you have is signals, like we call them, local little motifs that actually will tell you where to begin something or where to end something. And this is typically an ATG. The donors, acceptors, the splice sites basically, that are situated in the intron, at the border of the intron, the stop codon, which is an easy one. But all those signals need to be identified. And to give you an idea, in the software that we use, the prediction of splice sites is done using a support vector machine. Again, algorithms coming from speech recognition or machine learning, basically. So complex machine learning. Because to give you an idea, a support vector machine is sort of as if you would project every example, every motif that you find and which you label as being true, you basically put it in a multidimensional space. And with multidimensional, it can be thousands of dimensions. And the whole trick is to calculate, and then you feed it. So you feed it with the positive data, you feed it with the negative data. And then the training consists of drawing basically a separation, a frontier between the true and the negative. So this is in roughly a support vector machine. But this is, again, it's in multidimensional. So it's not like drawing a line somewhere or a plane. It's something with bubbles and cavities and things like that. So it's something that you cannot grasp in our sort of limited three-dimensional world. So it's quite complex calculations and software that you have to use. Okay, structural annotation. There's some drawbacks. And one of the major drawbacks is that in order to be able to design, calculate models, you actually need to have a training set. But that means that the training set, you need to be able to produce it. And that means that you sort of have to go back to manual annotation in order to generate a data set which is large enough in order to train your data, your models. And as each genome has its own style, for each new genome, of course, if the genomes are very, very much related, you could still use models that you already had from a previous time. But if it's really a new organism, you will have to basically build again a training set manually, store this, and from this annotation, the manual annotation, you will extract coding parts of exons, you will extract UTRs, you will extract donor sites, acceptor sites, etc., etc., and build those models based on that. Luckily, there are tricks to sort of avoid as much as possible the manual work. For instance, if you need introns, you can use RNA-seq. So that means that if you're working on a genome, you better have RNA-seq, because if you map RNA-seq using software like TopHat and other software, other mappers, they can map a read that is spanning an intron, which means a part of the read will be on one exon, the other part on the other exon, and that will actually define an intron. So if you map on your freshly assembled genome all your RNA-seq, not even knowing where the genes are, from that data you can already extract everything which is intron, donors, acceptors. So that part you already have covered. Then for the coding, non-coding, depending on the organism you're working, if it's a higher plant, maize, whatever, a higher plant, you can actually use the knowledge from rice, the gene models in rice or Arabidopsis, which are already relatively well annotated, to map them using a blast, for instance, to map them on the sequence, and this way find regions that are conserved at the protein level. And you know that then you can deduce then that those regions are actually coding for protein and so have a codon usage. And then using scripts, programming, so that means that you need to be able to program, you can extract, parse all this data and extract all this information, and this way accumulate enough information in order to make a prediction, to build model before making a prediction. But there's one thing, is that before, let's say earlier, 10, 15 years ago, you had mostly software that were actually built using statistical models, etc., to do a prediction. And then you had another software that's based on mapping of proteins, mapping of other extrinsic data, try to fix gene models. Because, unfortunately, prediction is only a prediction. So if in an eukaryotic genome you reach an accuracy of 60-70%, you're sort of already kind of happy. More is even better, but it's sometimes even hard to get to such a number. So even it requires quite a lot of work. And among the different extrinsic information, we can actually use many things. So there is similarities between protein and nucleic acids from sequence databases. Sometimes you can have a genome which is highly related, and you can actually and you can actually sort of align both genomes one with another, and this way find everything which is conserved between those two genomes, and use this sort of information in order to help you. This is typically something that you can use when you have strains of bacteria. As long as they don't reshuffle the whole genome, you can easily identify those microRNAs, long non-coding RNAs, and all those extra regulatory elements that are not coding for proteins, that are there as regulatory extras besides the expression of the proteins. Eukaryotic genes, on the other hand, are complex. It doesn't mean that because you have an eukaryote that the genes will be complex. There's some small algae, small organisms that also have a very simple gene structures. And that is most of the time relative to the size of the genome. because the if you have genes and you want to put introns in each of one of those genes, you need to have enough space in order to have those genes actually there. So the more compact a genome is, most of the time, the less difficult the gene structures are. So, and another thing is that, which is quite different, is that in prokaryotes, transcription and translation more or less goes together, because the genome of a prokaryote is not in a nucleus, so there's no compartmentation. While in an eukaryote, you have the nucleus, the genome is captured, is sitting in that nucleus. Transcription happens in the nucleus, and only after processing, because of course, if you have introns in gene models, once you want to translate your transcript, those introns need to be actually removed, excised. And so you have the whole spliceosome, a whole machinery of RNAs and proteins that are needed to actually process the whole transcript. And because of that, you cannot transcribe in one go. You can only transcribe, process your transcript, and then only translate. And that's why you have this compartmentalization. So but basically everything what happens with the transcript at the RNA level is confined in the nucleus, and the translation will happen in the cytoplasm. So a basic structure of a gene, as I said, you have a promoter to actually regulate the gene. Then you have a series of exons and introns. And from the exons, it's for the first and the last exon, for instance, only a part will be translated. The part which is not translated is called the UTR, untranslated region, and is actually the region that is needed for a ribosome to assemble and then to start the translation. You have a gene, you transcribe it, and you obtain a molecule like this one. Then you have the splicing, and you obtain a molecule like this one. And it's only at this stage that translation can happen, and that you can actually obtain a protein. So this is quite different compared to prokaryotes. Basically, with prokaryotes, you do everything at once. But there's some basic rules. The CDS, like we call, that is the part of the gene between ATG and stop codon, so that's the equivalent of an ORF in prokaryotes, is modulo 3, a multiple of 3. And that is simply because you have codons. Each codon is composed of 3 nucleotides, and from ATG to stop, you need to have this multiple of 3 present. In most, if not all eukaryotes, in most eukaryotes, you have a gene will always start with an ATG. It's very rare to have something else than an ATG to start a gene in eukaryotes. In prokaryotes, bacteria and archaea, so there basically you can have many, many different things that can act as a start codon. So that makes sort of a bit, of course, the prokaryotic gene prediction a bit complicated, because if you have many options where to start a gene, it complicates things. But luckily, it's actually related to a specific organism, and then all the genes will have the same signal. So one organism might use, for instance, an ATT as a start codon, while another prokaryote might use, again, the ATG, and yet another might use something else. So that's the only thing that you have to take into account with prokaryotes, is that are the signals in the sequence the same for your new organism, the same as is already known. And it might be different. So the stop codons in eukaryotes, again, typically you have 3, TAG, TAA, and TGA. And you have, so the if you have a gene with introns, typically an intron will start with a, when in a big majority, with a GT or a GC, but it's like 98% will be GT and 2% will be GC, and stops with an AG. And those motifs are actually important in order to make the whole splicing working. And you have to take into account that also eukaryotes, given that transcription and the processing, so the splicing of the transcripts happens at different times, you have to take into account that, for instance, so what you have is here, you have an exon, this whole part, and actually the A from the ATG is this one. And the TG can be on the next exon. So when you predict genes, typically predicting UTRs, so this part, is quite difficult because there's no codon bias and it resembles a lot basically the promoter in composition. So it's hard to define where actually the first exon is really starting. But that means that if you want to do a gene prediction, and that is often the reason why you might have errors, if you have genes like this, is that this will be okay to read, to recognize, because the statistics will be okay, but for this one, the single nucleotide, statistical models will never work. So what will happen is that your prediction software will see this, and then it will try to find a way to have still an ATG somewhere. And it will might try to find it an ATG that might fit, so where you have splice sites and everything, which all the signals fit, but having a bigger piece. Because the bigger piece you can recognize, the single nucleotide you cannot. In order to correct this, the only way is through extrinsic data, RNA-seq, ESTs, or protein alignments. So, and also, what you have is that in GenBank or any other database, if you have a model which is like this, and you always in an EMBL format, or all those formats that describe annotation, the CDS, the first so-called CDS exon, will be size 1. And so this is sort of, and I put this here simply because people don't realize this necessarily. Certainly, to give you a little anecdote, on a genome, on a Pico algae that we were working on, the PI on the project was coming from a prokaryotic world. And basically, after we did the prediction, and that she manually looked a little bit at the genes, she said, well, everything is wrong because those exons are not modulo 3. Because she was, for her, basically each exon one had to be modulo 3. So she didn't have the whole, or she didn't grasp the whole concept of exons that have to be put together in order to have an ORF on the transcript. So she was basically messing up the whole data. So we had to call her back, teach her how an eukaryotic gene looks like, and in order to make sure that she wouldn't mess up too much the results that we predicted. So, and as I said before, because it's only the final spliced transcript that needs to be modulo 3, when you see the gene structure in a genome, you will see that each exon can be on a different reading frame. So on each strand of your DNA, you have three reading frame, and each reading frame corresponds with where you start your codon. So at the first position, second position, or third position. So you have different reading frames. But that means that you can have exons on two different reading frames, but once you put them together, actually, again, the whole transcript will be have a CDS, which is modulo 3. So when you do annotation for mostly protein coding genes, you can have four different types of exons, the single exon gene. So basically starts with an HEG, stops with a stop codon, and everything is in between, and there's no intron. And then you have initial exons that contain a piece of UTR and then a piece of CDS, or only UTR. You can have perfectly have splicing at the level of the UTRs. There's no problem. It is all possible. Internal exons only contain coding. And then the terminal exon, which will contain the final part of the CDS or not, and basically extend until you have the poly-A signal. As transcriptin eukaryotes also have a poly-A signal, and that the poly-A itself, which is attached to the transcript in eukaryotes, is actually not coded in the DNA. So it's being added afterwards, after transcription. And then you have this poly-A that sometimes can be quite long, is being added to the transcript. And this is quite convenient in the sense that you can use this as a way to capture mRNAs, for instance. You can design a probe, a poly-T probe, that will actually hybridize with the poly-A. And it's also thought that the length of this poly-A tail that you add to your transcript actually determines how long your transcript will be around. Because normally, when you want to regulate your how the cells function, okay, you have your genome, the genes are coded on the genome, you have to transcribe them, you translate them into proteins, but once they're done, they need to be discarded. You don't want your transcript to stay around forever, because then you lose actually control. So they need to be discarded quickly. And therefore, the longer the poly-A tail, the longer the transcript will survive. And of course, in reverse, the shorter it is, the quicker it will be discarded. So that you can have a quick transcription, one transcript, a bit of translation, maybe only once, and then directly you discard the transcript. You destroy it. And of course, if you think about it, that's quite a waste of energy. Because each time you make a transcript, you translate it maybe once, twice, oops, gone. And if you want to have it again, you need to transcribe it, go through the whole process all over again. I already said those things. So if you have transcripts, actually you can rely on this. It will delineate the exons, the boundaries. It will allow you to also add the UTRs that you were not able to predict because there's no bias in there. So the transcript is a kind of a nice evidence. Can be from ESTs or assembled RNA-seq. The proteins will help you to actually identify the CDS, so the coding part of all those. But as I said, prediction is only a prediction. So anyway, you will have to, at some point, you will have to actually look again at the prediction, at what you produced. And again, this is manual, unfortunately. So basically, manually, you will have to inspect your gene models and actually assess the different types of information in order to be able to say, well, yes, this gene is correct, and we can move on. Typically, most occurring is exon boundaries that are mispredicted. The untranslated region is most of the time missing or too short. Then what you also have is isoforms. Isoforms, so that means alternatively spliced genes. So alternative splice, that means that you can have a transcript, and that because of some conditions, an exon is, for instance, skipped. So from exon 1, you go to directly to exon 3, and you continue like this, missing actually exon 2. Exon 2 might contain some protein domain that is not needed in a certain condition, and so you skip an exon. Predicting isoforms is actually almost impossible. And the reason is that it's a combinatorial problem, actually. So suppose you have all the exons, all the possible exons, and if you have a gene, and actually in the human genome, there's some genes that have 100,000 alternative transcripts simply because it shuffles or it chooses each time another combination of exons. Typically in the immune system, the human immune system, you have genes that do this. That actually, by shuffling with exons and playing with exons, they make motifs and they make domains that are actually able to recognize pathogens, etc. So, and this you cannot predict, as I said, completely with the prediction, because it's a combinatorial problem, because once you have all the exons, you have no idea which exon combinations you can use. In theory, you could say, well, all possible combinations can be actually used, but that's not the case. There's really very specific things going on during the transcription and the splicing that actually make these alternative transcripts. And for the moment, we do not really know what sort of information, which is, because this information somewhere is coded on the sequence, but we don't know yet what sort of information we need to use in order to be able to say, okay, this exon can be sometimes skipped or not. But intrinsic, normally there should be something coded, written in the genome, that might be recognized by some proteins that will actually trigger all this. And it might be actually not necessarily coded at the locus where the gene is sitting, but it might be, for instance, a microRNA, a long non-coding RNA, that actually might hybridize with the transcript, and this way make some splicing impossible. So that's still quite sort of unknown, an uncharted actually area. Okay. And of course, in order to do manual annotation, luckily we have, and I'll show you some of these later, we have browsers typically. You have like the GBrowse and others that are available, and where you can basically graphically represent all those alignments and all this information, so that the visual inspection will be much easier. Functional annotation, typically you want to give the gene a name, preferably a name that is meaningful, that would ring a bell with other people. You can have gene symbols. So gene symbols are typically a 3 or 5 letter code that summarizes the gene product name. An EC number, so enzymatic code. This is a four-digit like an IP address that is actually that refers to a hierarchical structure of protein functions. So it's hierarchical, and each number is basically on another level and describes proteins, enzymes, and the descriptions that are available under the EC numbers are really proteins that were thoroughly studied. So where they know exactly what sort of chemical reaction they trigger, what their actually function is. Another part of function annotation is, for instance, expression. Sometimes you can have an hypothetical gene for which you have no clue what it is, But if you have evidence through EGSTs or RNA-seq that it is expressed, you sort of have a way to say, well, this gene is actually expressed. It's not just a prediction. Gene ontology is also something which is quite popular. It's used a lot, and it sort of complements the information which is stored under the EC numbers. And this way, and also covers metabolic functions, covers different aspects of biology. Another difference between gene ontology and EC numbers is that gene ontology is a graph, it's not a tree, which means that you can have loops in that system, which makes it sometimes a bit difficult. Or you can have two parents getting to the same child, so that so it's not purely hierarchical system. And one other thing is also that functional annotation is basically based on similarity. And this has sort of a disadvantage in the sense that sometimes you can have sometimes you can have a gene which was predicted. It's a nice big gene. It has some protein domains. And somewhere, someone saw my gene A has homology with with some gene that I found in the database, which is gene B. But gene B might overlap like this way. So they might share a protein domain, but only that protein domain. And then if you come with gene C, it might actually, if this is now B, it might also align like this way. And then you would say, well, this is an A-like, because this one was called A-like, but they have nothing in common anymore. So that means that in functional annotation, you can have very often propagation of errors if you're not cautious enough. Then, also, when you make a functional annotation and you give it a name, actually there are some conventions that you have to respect. Like typically if you have a real clear homology and everything is fine, basically the gene is labeled as known or putative, but known is definitely the most trustworthy labeling. Then, as I said, genes can sometimes have or lack homology with others. Certainly, again, in bacteria, you can have definitely genes that are sort of new, and that's why you're doing metagenomics, or to have a metaproteome of your environment. But basically, if you have transcripts, whether it's EGSTs or RNA-seq, you can actually label it as an expressed gene. If actually none of the above fits, so there's barely any reliable protein homology, there is no EST, no transcript that is actually confirming the motif, it will be labeled hypothetical. So a hypothetical is a purely predicted gene without any other evidence. I was talking about EC numbers, so from the enzyme commission. And typically, you have numbers that, so four digits separated by a dot, and that particular address corresponds with hyaluron lyase. Later on, when you will do a little bit of playing around with genes, we will go to this website here, to the www.expressi.ch, and this one is a website that sort of collects a lot of proteins, protein databases, and protein-based tools to actually try to figure out what a gene might be, what it might be doing. So Also, one thing is that we, when we do a gene prediction, so the automated gene prediction, we always try to invite expert annotators, like we call them, and they're expert on certain gene families, in order to basically double check on the annotation, and then we expect them, not of course, that they improve the annotation. But across the different genomes that are institutes that work on genomes, there's a sort of three basic models, is that they produce an annotation and that's it. They try to do it as good as possible, but that's what they have, and they upload it into GenBank, and that's what the annotation is going to be, and it's sort of frozen. And it might be good. Most of the time it's not super, but okay, so they don't touch it anymore. In many cases, the reason, and certainly more recently, when you're sequencing a whole genome, actually the sequencing and the annotation is like one paragraph in your whole paper. Creating those, even though you have to spend a lot of money and time in order to create those resources, it's actually only seen as a resource. So that means that it's quite of pushed down somehow, but in order then still to sell your paper, you actually need to have a biological story. And again, here you have then the expert annotators coming in, and also that means that you will not sequence whatever genome. You will first think, okay, what's the interesting story I can tell about this genome? What is actually interesting? And then you might say, yes, okay, we're going to do this genome or not. What we most of the time do is that we have a website where all this information is stored, and we actually leave it open the whole time. So basically that means that the annotation is in an eternal flux. That means that it's always been updated, improved. Okay, so I've been talking about eukaryotic gene finding, and here you have a little list of all sorts of software that are available. Some are old, actually, are not used anymore even, because they were too focused on a single or on limited number of organisms, or, and that's the case, for instance, for those three here, GeneMark, Augustus, and Eugene. And I will go more in detail with. So, in order to make some demos, you can maybe have a look at the first URL. So you go to this web page. And basically you click on this button here. I hope you have Java installed on your systems. Normally you should. Doesn't want to open it right away. So you have to go to this thing, click on this little one on the magnifying glass. And then it will bring you to the file, and then you have to say that you want to open it with Java. That's something related to the Mac itself. So you will have this sort of window run. Do you have connections? Can you load something? Because mine is saying that I have no network. Okay, so if I have no network, I cannot. So normally you will have sort of a window that should appear with some organisms. So you can click on one of those organisms. You can just choose whatever. Click on a picture. Choose one. Strange. I have an internet connection, but I cannot reach it. Does it work for you?
I don't have connection.
You also have no connection. There it's okay. There also, on the orange button. On a phone. It might be a bit big to draw it on a phone. Try it, you never know, but does it start up for you? Or the network is a bit slow. You have? It's loading. Okay, maybe too many people trying to load it at the same time. Sir?
I work in Google.
Mm-hmm. Ah, you did the download. Yeah, you don't have to download. Well, yeah. Try run. Okay, well. Which genome did you take? The C. elegans? I think it's... So, depending on the genome that you chose, you will have more or less information. Like, which genome did you choose?
A fungal genome?
And there's nothing. Well, no, you have gene models still. So have a look on, I think it's the first or the second genome when you open it. And there you will have, for instance, RNA-seq and other things mapped on the sequence. And browse around a little bit, go back and forth. And I'm going to try again. Okay, so doesn't want to show on the screen. Okay, so here you don't have so much. And so each time you click on another genome, you can see below here that you're actually downloading more information from different places. So here, this is from the C. elegans, so the little worm that you find in soil. Connection is a bit slow. Okay, it's coming. So using, it's still coming in. So you can browse there, you can go back and forth, you can see gene models. And what you can do is take one of those proteins that you have, and you can, so here for instance you have the RNA-seq. So if I zoom out, you should be able to see more. Okay, it's too slow to actually work with. So I proposed that as a little exercise, you take one of those genes, so you can click on it to select it, and in the menu, you have selection, and there you can actually select the sequence, DNA sequence, and you can translate it. This way you have the protein sequence. Does that work for everybody? Does it work for you? It's slow. Yeah. That's when too many, good morning, too many people connecting at the same time. Well, it's a bit slow. I want to show a tool and
okay,
it's a bit slow. So we have to be a bit patient. So yeah, you have sequence, so you can show DNA or protein. Did you select something? Oh no. You have to select a gene, like this one. You just click on it. No, just below. No, no. This one. Yeah. And then you can translate it. And then, is it working for everybody? Or is it too slow? You connected or you still? Still no. Try to reopen it, because when I reopened it, it was okay. So most of the people actually loaded it now.